It is humbling to be in the presence, not of one bishop, but of two bishops. The great Bishop Graves, whose son will be singing at Ruach, the legendary bishop, and another legendary bishop, Henry Williamson. If you will please stand, gentlemen, so we can acknowledge your presence. I'm sorry if the hall isn't big enough to accommodate the crowd for our distinguished guest. So my only request is, if you are my age or younger, 53 or younger, and you see someone older come in, offer your seat to that person. If you're able to stand, please do. If we can fill in all the empty seats, let's fill them in. Please raise your hand if there are any empty seats beside you. Ladies and gentlemen, please, if you'll keep it down now, as I say in one sentence.
Seats here.
Since I spoke for 10 minutes about him in the sanctuary. Keep your hands raised if there's an open seat. Thank you. We have until 1:30, however he wants to use it. I hope he just lets it out. Without further ado, the 18th president of the largest, oldest, most well-respected civil rights organization in America and arguably the world, one which I hope everyone will become a member of when Yom Kippur ends this evening, NAACP.org's leader, Cornell William Brooks.
Good afternoon. Mike, I have to tell you, Rabbi, I have to tell you that these serial introductions can be a bit intimidating. First, I'd like to just express my deep, profound, heartfelt appreciation for the honor standing in this place at this time for this extraordinary, historic congregation whose roots extend back to 1854. Only a few years before the Civil War, only a few years before another congregation filled with people I also love was born in Georgetown, South Carolina. That would be the Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church. I feel here like I would there, at home. To our National Board of Directors, of which your rabbi is a leading member, to the members of the NAACP here present, to our congressional representatives, elected officials, most importantly, that vanguard generation of prophets rising up in this temple. That is to say, our young people. Can we put our hands together for them? Now, after that introduction, I feel like I need to just disabuse you of a few myths and stereotypes. By virtue of a modest little story, I'm reminded of a time many years ago as a young, innocent, naive, presumptuous preacher, true story, I found myself in London, England on a Sunday morning. As a young, innocent, naive, presumptuous preacher, standing outside of this beautiful Gothic cathedral with spires soaring toward the heavens, Stained glass windows reflecting the iridescent, multi-hued, multicolored beauty of God. As a young, innocent, naive, presumptuous preacher standing outside of this beautiful Gothic cathedral on a Sunday morning, I suppose and presuppose that there were about 2,000 or so folks inside waiting to hear this young, innocent, presumptuous preacher preach. But unlike this august congregation, I walked inside and I discovered the pastor and exactly two members. I need you all to keep this true story to yourselves. So I made my way into the congregation, noticed the pastor and exactly two members. One member I called Miss Jones, the other member I called Miss Smith. Now I did as I was taught to do, which is to say that you preach, you share, you speak to two people in the same way that you would to a synagogue of this size, which is to say with sincerity, with conviction, with a sense of the weight of one's calling. So I made my way into the pulpit and I immediately noticed the obvious, that Miss Jones immediately fell asleep. But now this inspired me only to preach and speak with more fervor. And I immediately noticed the obvious that the member I called Miss Smith seemed to hang on to every word I had to say. She clapped her hands, she tapped her feet, she nodded her head, and as is the tradition in my Zion, she said hallelujah and amen. And I thought to myself, at least I'm reaching one somebody this Sunday morning. Well, I concluded my little homily, made my way out of the pulpit, and the pastor said to me, Brother Brooks, I'm so sorry, just so sorry. Miss Jones falls asleep on everybody. And Miss Smith is out of her mind and did not understand what thank you had to say. So you can see why I'm so delighted on this Day of Atonement to be in the midst of this congregation on this deeply moving and momentous day in my life and ministry. I'm reminded that as I stand here on this Yom Kippur day, this Day of Atonement, marked on the calendar of memory and time, that I'm not here and you are not here as a matter of happenstance. We're not here as a matter of circumstance. We are here at a particular moment in time that does not represent a random mark on the Gregorian calendar. It is not simply a chime on your mobile device or your cell phone. We're here at a particular moment in history. I'm reminded that at this agonizing hour in America, that between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur in upstate New York, a Jewish cemetery was desecrated with swastikas and anti-Semitic graffiti at this anguishing hour in America. I'm reminded that in the holy interregnum between Rosh Hashanah and this Day of Atonement, someone took the occasion to lift up an anti-Semitic message. We well understand that such a message, anti-Semitism being the ugly offspring of fear and hate, it is not an uncommon occurrence in this country. We understand that this is a peculiar moment in time in which Americans and citizens of good conscience are being tested, called upon to exercise our prophetic sensibilities, our prophetic impulse, our courage, our commitment, our bravery, our intestinal fortitude as a people. I'm reminded that at this moment, that it is instructive that we consider the history of a modest band of freedom fighters that came into being 170 years ago. Were you to turn the gilded pages of history, you might come across a band of freedom fighters known as the NAACP.
And at this moment where some may be tempted to be discouraged and disillusioned and depressed and skeptical about the power to atone for our sins, skeptical about the power of seeking forgiveness through righteousness, through justice, through fasting of the heart, of the mind, and of our actions. When you look at the history of the NAACP, here's what you find. Over 107 years ago, a ragtag group of progressives, of which there were only a few African Americans, not a few Jewish Americans, who came together to stand against injustice in New York City. You come upon an organization that defined itself by its name, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Now, I know that that may seem linguistically anachronistic in this postmodern era, but may I remind you what your children know all too well, being familiar with a box of Crayola crayons. People like crayons come in all colors. And so when you say, and you hear this up, an organization called the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, it simply means we advance all colored people. Red, yellow, black, or white, you're all precious in God's sight. This may strike some as morally counterintuitive in this age of police misconduct, where there is an open and vigorous debate as to whether black lives matter or all lives matter. We at the NAACP, having fought lynching to a standstill in the last century, having taken up the cause of fighting another form of lynching in this century called police conduct, misconduct, we understand all too well that when we say black lives matter, it is a moral predicate to the ethical conclusion that all lives matter. Unless black lives matter, it cannot be said that all lives matter. We've never been afraid to assert loudly, clearly, with moral clarity, that we believe that all lives matter, whether your skin is black or your uniform is blue. We say it everywhere. We've said it in Ferguson. We've said it in Cleveland. When we said it in North Charleston. We've said it when it was popular. We said it when it was unpopular. When you turn the pages of the history of the NAACP, we understand that this organization draws deeply from a canon of social justice. By canon of social justice, what do you mean by that? It's the Torah that's taught in the school of this synagogue, Sunday schools and churches all across the country. It's the religion, the faith of the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Amos. When people wonder, well, is there a schism, is there a divide between African Americans and American Jews? I point you to this canon of social justice. May I remind you as a matter of theology that when you consider the black church standing tall on the landscape of social justice like a cathedral of hope, the black church would not be the Zion it is without the religion of Judaism. Let's be clear about this. Prophetic religion transformed slave religion into a fighting religion. A religion that fights for justice, that fights for righteousness, that fights for the transformation of the society. The black church is built on the foundation of American synagogues and prophetic religion. We're in a moment in our history where we need to seriously ponder what we have in common rather than that which divides us. May I share with you a modest little story why I'm connected to this little talk as a matter of biography and autobiography, not merely a matter of theology and philosophy. I had a very southern grandma by the name of Miss Rosalie Prelo from Georgetown, South Carolina. And as a little boy, when I got beside myself, she would pull me aside and she'd say to me, "Cornell, don't think too much of yourself. Because when you came to the world, you did not make a great first impression." She said to me, "You weighed 3 pounds and 3 ounces. And when you were born, the doctors rushed to the side of your mother and said your son likely will not live beyond the end of the day. And they told my mother that if you're religious, you need to have someone come in and pray over this child. I was born at Fort Bliss in El Paso, Texas, in General William Beaumont Hospital, a military installation. So the clergy available at that time were chaplains in the U.S. Army. So they said to my mother, if you're religious, you need to get somebody in here to pray for your child. So they looked high and low for a Catholic chaplain. None to be found. Looked high and low for a Protestant chaplain. None to be found. But they did find a rabbi. Now we don't know what he did to bring about a Methodist baptism. But my grandmother, Rosalie Prelo, told me that story because she wanted me to understand that where you find your blessing, where you find your nourishment, is close to us. Judaism is a part of black religion. My grandmother swore up and down to her dying day that I am where I am as a consequence of her prayers and the prayers of that rabbi. Who am I and who are you to say she was wrong? So I come to this place believing very deeply that this is a testing hour in America. We find ourselves in the midst of a post-millennium civil rights movement that is bigger and broader than the Black Lives Matter movement. It includes bringing to an end this era of mass incarceration. It includes bringing police misconduct to an end. It includes ending voter suppression. It includes taking on homophobia, anti-Semitism. It includes taking on any wrong with the prophetic religion that brought us to where we are. This civil rights movement, it's not your grandparents' civil rights movement, it's your grandchildren's civil rights movement. It's a civil rights movement that calls us to stand together as a multi-generational, multi-racial, multi-ethnic army of justice. This civil rights movement is infused with the energy, the power, the insight, the inspiration of our forebears, our foremothers, and our forefathers. But make no mistake, it is a movement where we need that coalition of African Americans and American Jews. I say that because there's a lot to be learned and a lot to be gleaned from the history that we inherited. But it's not a dead history. May I remind you, last summer, when the NAACP purposed within its heart to march from Selma, Alabama to Washington, D.C. for the right to vote, a geographic span of 1,002 miles, we started out at the Edmund Pettus Bridge as a diverse collection, congregation of justice seekers. But may I remind you, that we had, yes, carpenters and teachers and police officers, members of the NAACP, members of the labor movement, but according to my Methodist math, We also had one out of every 10 reform rabbis in the United States on that march from Selma to Washington, D.C. Make no mistake, this is not a nostalgic coalition. This is a now coalition. We have a generation of millennials who are talking about the ways in which African Americans and American Jews can stand together today. We are inspired by Heschel. We are inspired by Martin Luther King. But we are inspired by the justice movement in our midst right now, and our children and our grandchildren and their grandparents and our parents are yet leading this movement now. The battle was tough. When we consider that in the wake of the Shelby versus Holder Supreme Court decision, we have seen a Machiavellian frenzy of voter disenfranchisement from one end of the country to the other. We have seen state legislature after state legislature engage in a new millennium form of voter suppression. This is not your grandparents' voter suppression, that is to say black, white, 1950. But rather, this is a multiracial, multi-ethnic, multi-generational voter suppression. So in other words, it's not merely African Americans having their votes denied and suppressed. Not merely Latinos having their votes denied and suppressed. When we think about the fact that in Texas, the state legislature passed a law which allowed an ID that allows you to carry a concealed weapon permit. Deemed to be sufficient civic and democratic proof to vote. But an ID which allows you to carry a book of Shakespeare, a book of English, a book of chemistry, a college textbook deemed to be insufficient civic and democratic proof to vote. But one organization went to the Fifth Circuit U.S. Court of Appeals, and we literally won back the right to vote for 600,000 citizens in Texas. That would be the NAACP. Multiracial, multi-ethnic, multi-generational form of voter suppression. We've also seen in the state of North Carolina, not merely blacks having their right to vote denied, or Latinos, but what about the fact when you honor an ID which allows you to walk across the campus of Camp Lejeune or Fort Bragg, but you don't honor the ID of a student at Duke University, North Carolina A&T University, North Carolina State University? What happens when in the state of Alabama 500,000 votes and voters are in peril by unconstitutional activity of the state legislature? What happens when you require and request that everyone have a government-issued photo ID and then you close down the DMVs in African-American communities? And what happens when you not only deny African Americans the right to vote, but in those black counties, young people who are seeking an ID for not only voting, but also going to the prom? That's not just a war on African Americans, it's a war by the older against those who are younger. And so here we are in the midst of this multiracial, multi-ethnic form of voter suppression. When we need an organization that is bringing people together, we need an organization that represents stand-up, grown-up leadership. I don't mean geriatric leadership. I don't mean elderly leadership. I mean leadership that represents the whole of us, in all of our diverse colors and generations. That would be the NAACP. Can I give you an example? I believe one of your members is here. Who marched with us from the home of Michael Brown to the home of the governor, Jay Nixon, in Missouri. 30-degree, 20-degree weather. Ice storms, cold, because we were standing against police misconduct. Let me paint a picture for you. The NAACP marches into a little town called Rosebud, Missouri. In that town, the people chose to exercise their racial animus with First Amendment vigor. That is to say, they had Confederate flags waving, watermelons on display, malt liquor bottles on display, cursing us. But here's what I noticed. A member of your congregation came with her three boys, showed up from Memphis in Missouri. We talked on the back of the bus about what she was likely to hear. We talked about the N-word and those children in the NAACP marches literally marched through hell. But can I tell you this? We weren't intimidated. I remember our state conference president, Ms. Mary Ratliff, 70 years old, walking tall in her constitutional dignity, with people calling her the N-word left and right. I remember a sheriff telling me that he was not going to provide any form of protection. And being inspired by that 70-year-old grandmother, I told him these words. Sir, the Attorney General is well aware of this march. And if anything happens to me or my people, you can explain to him what happened. But I'm going to tell you this. You got about exactly 5 minutes to turn around, do your job, because we're going to march right through the middle of your town. He capitulated, not to me, but to the spirit of the NAACP. That's the moment we're in. We're in a moment where we really need a strong, powerful, prophetic coalition. We need a coalition of those who are seeking justice and who are willing to do anything necessary to bring it about as a matter of conscience. I want to close with a little story that illustrates how much determination we need. On that journey for justice, when we marched from Selma to D.C., I met a man by the name of Middle Passage. He met me at the foot of the Edmund Pettus Bridge. He caught a ride there from Rabbi Bruce Lustig out of Washington, D.C. He met us at the foot of the Edmund Pettus Bridge, and he told us he wanted to march all the way to Washington, D.C., and that he wanted to carry the American flag the whole distance. Middle Passage was 67 years old, a veteran of the Navy, a veteran of Vietnam, and he marched with that flag 900 miles to regain his Spotsylvania, Virginia. And when we came to Spotsylvania, Virginia, Middle Passage, noting a rainstorm, wrapped up the American flag. But when the sun came out, the clouds parted, the blue sky emerged, he unfurled the flag. And when he did so, he literally collapsed to the ground. My hardest day at the NAACP was telling a group of school children that Middle Passage did not make it. The hardest question I've ever been asked at the NAACP was by those same school children. If a man was willing to die for the right to vote, why can't we vote and fight for the right to vote? On that journey for justice, we didn't stop in Spotsylvania, Virginia. We made it all the way to Washington, D.C. And when we ended in a place called the Washington Hebrew Congregation, about the same age as this congregation. We ended in a place of prayer. We ended in a place of justice. We ended in a place of peace. We ended in a place of love. And I say to you on this Day of Atonement that it is in this sacred place that we find the love, the justice, the compassion, the power we need to make this journey of justice that we find ourselves on. This is a moment on this day. Let us understand within our hearts that we have to fast with justice, fast with courage, fast with commitment. And as we understand all too well, knowing the theology of this day, that on the Day of Atonement, one atones for one's sins against God. One atones for one's sins with your neighbor before this day. And so we, understanding our faith, need to atone throughout the year. And we do that by seeking justice. And so I leave you with this modest little hymn of the NAACP. If you grow discouraged, if you grow weary, bear these words in mind. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on, let us march on, let us march on, let us march on, till victory is won.
As I said in the sanctuary, please be seated. Who needs food for the soul when you have justice for the soul? Reverend President Brooks is correct. This day does not atone for sins against other people, only between us and God. And we know about the NAACP, and this whole day at 3 o'clock, it's a way to get involved with Daniel Keel's panel. With leaders from the justice community. If you say, I don't know what I can do, President Brooks has given us one way nationally, of course our local branch, NAACP.org, and then come at 3 o'clock and get inspired and get involved. President Brooks said that he would take questions, so anyone, please, anything you want to ask, but we're afraid to ask. We have time. Mr. Sloves, I'm going to repeat the question for the video.
I grew up in New York during the time when there was a coalition African when did that coalition start to turn together?
So the gentleman with the southern accent said, I grew up in New York, South New York. And I'm curious to know what President Brooks says about that. Full confession, I came here because of you and Rabbi Danziger and because of a book chapter I wrote on Southern Rabbis and Black Civil Rights, University of Alabama Press in 94. My father, blessed memory, and I did a survey of hundreds of people like you, Harold, rabbis as well, who were involved. One of the things that we found is, I know you're only 45, but since the heyday that we talk about of yesteryear, take a word like survival. What does survival mean for Jews? It means questions like, will my grandchildren be Jewish? Will there be a Jewish community here 15 years? It's a future question. There began to be an inward tilt we found in the predominantly African-American communities and in the Jewish communities. And it's led to an unfortunate forgetfulness of memory, as President Brooks reminded us, that what we share in common is so much greater and not some frou-frou way. Read Andrew Young's biography, he'll tell you that his feeling at home is why I feel more at home in a Bishop Graves church and why Will Graves will be here for Ruach following this. So that's what we found from the survey, that after the 60s there became an inward tilt. Survival is a present day question for much of the African American community. It's not a question for tomorrow, and poverty, for instance, and of course there are many wealthy African-Americans, but poverty disproportionately in this city. People say, how come people don't make the right choices? Well, poverty robs you of choice. We're thinking about our to-do list. Some people are checking about, I'm missing work today. What am I doing tomorrow? Imagine not just that you missed this meal because you're fasting today like I am and you are, but if it's an everyday occurrence. But I'm curious to hear from President Brooks, what happened to that coalition?
So I think the rabbi has named it well. I would only add here that I think there are moments where the anecdotal and the episodic become emblematic and universal. So in other words, you have one person who says something anti-Semitic, one leader, one figure. This is morally extrapolated to the whole. I like to challenge us to look not just at what the leaders do, look at what the so-called followers do. So when I think about my church in Washington, D.C., Turner Memorial African Methodist Episcopal Church, which I believe is the only such church or one of few that was a synagogue for many years, became an AME church, then became a synagogue again. It is now the historic 15th Street Synagogue in Washington, D.C. I worshiped, preached under the Star of David for 15 years. The relationships between churches and synagogues all across this country have continued, existed. That coalition is real. Sometimes it's been ruptured, it's been fragmented, it's been tested. But let us go back to the canon. Go back to our sacred book. And the reason I say that is because when I read the story of Passover, it's not about the past tense. It's about the present tense. The story is now. We read it in terms of who we are as captives, as exiles, as slaves in this moment. It's not about a dead theology. It's about a live theology. And so I think it's important for us in terms of our prophetic tradition to tap into that. Number two, let's understand the moment we're in. We see all across this country, just an incredible rise in hate crimes. We see anti-Semitism, an ugly racism, an ugly misogyny. If we don't come together at this moment and be thoughtful about how we work together, then I'm not sure when we will. And also, let us not be divided by let's not be divided by those things which can be cured with more thoughtful analysis, with compassion, with reason, and with working together. So for example, much has been made of the statement in the Black Lives Matter platform on Israel. I'd like to believe that you can correct a great many things with history, with teaching, with engagement, with love. But if you're not standing together, it's a little hard to walk together.
And to return to his word of the canon, a true story in Memphis, Tennessee. My twin, he's tall, dark, and handsome, Keith Norman. I'm short, white, and aging. And we always go around as twins. His church is right around where Crosstown and the Old Temple are. He's also on the NAACP president of our Memphis branch. And Reverend Kyle is a blessed memory, who many of you have heard at your schools, was like a rabbi. I keep a picture of him and me on my desk. And years ago, probably 20 years ago, he said, "Micah, I'd love to experience Passover Seder with you." So we went over the symbols. And first of all, he made a very interesting comment, because you know the Seder plate? You know, if you're not Jewish, you're like, is that all there is to the meal? Get some horseradish and some poor man's bread and a little water. I mean, no, we haven't even gotten to the matzo ball soup yet. So the haroset, which looks like, what does it symbolize? Mortar, exactly, symbolized the bricks of slavery. It's the best tasting thing on the Seder plate. So the rabbis ask, he says, this really symbolizes mortar. He's like, this is great. This is delicious. And I said, yeah, because the early rabbis said the worst kind of slavery is when you're so numb and disengaged that slavery tastes sweet to the slave, that you don't even know you're enslaved. And he immediately said, that reminds me, after Rosa Parks wouldn't go to the back of the bus, a lot of us copied her. I don't know, Bishop Graves, you and Rabbi Wax. But I think he said it was an August day in 1960, early 60s in Memphis, Tennessee. You know, no air conditioning on those buses. It was 120 degrees with a wind chill. And the driver said, N-word to Reverend Kyles, get to the back of the bus. And he said, I'm not going. It's my right to sit here. He said, I'm going to arrest you. He said, then you have to arrest me, sir. I am not moving. Minutes passed by that seemed like an eternity. The police had yet to come. And voices started saying, get back here, we have to get to work. And he said, those weren't white folks, those were black folks. Is that what the haroset means? I said, Billy, you understand this symbol better than I ever will. The cannon is there to engage. But as he said, some leader spouts off and people disengage. So I think it's all substance when it comes to our shared justice prophetic faith. It's not hype. So the canon is what will bring us together. Questions out there? Other questions, please. In the back. Yes. Please. Okay. The question is, don't you think Donald Trump's going through here? We want to keep our 501c3 status at Temple Israel. I want to be very clear. I want to be very clear that it's not a matter of being politic. It's a matter of being honest that we are, as President Brooks was talking about the justice issues, I was shepping nachas, that's Yiddish for taking pride, in Congressman Cohen and what you do on behalf of all those issues he talked about. And that's not a political statement, that's an honest statement. And we shut nachas, I don't know if the congressional candidate David Kustoff is here, so we are a big house. And so I really would not want us to get into that issue. This is a day where we're talking about principles. But thank you. I'm not saying that to stifle dissent, but we only have 15 more minutes with the leader of the NAACP. Yes, sir.
What can we say to our co-religionists when we see them at the Jewish Community Center who say that their economic alignment, their economic interest is such that they can't support a liberation movement?
What can we do about our Jewish co-religionists who are insular and for whatever reason says that we can't? I would tell them to read the Torah. You know, Hillel said, when asked, what is Judaism, standing on one foot, he said, what is hateful to you, do not do to another person. I'm not sure that was the best answer, because it's only said a few times in the Bible. Do you know what it said 36 times? Love the other. Love the stranger. Love the outcast. Love the vulnerable. Because you were that. 36 times. So I would just say, you know, you have the prayer book. Read Isaiah 58 that he read today. Tell me what that's about. And it's not cherry picking. 36 times. Yes, please. Oh, one of our youth leaders. There she is, a regional officer of the nifty Southern Region. Let's hear it. Miss Emma Mansburg.
Good. Finally, question for him. You get me all the time.
What is your dream that we could be doing to really make change in our community and in our nation?
So
Let me just start by saying you're doing a lot already, and we want to see you do even more. And here's what I mean. First of all, one thing that you can do is, one, don't romanticize your elders, right? So in other words, when you read the history books and you look over your shoulder of history, it's easy to think about Julian Bond and John Lewis as elder statesmen, as opposed to young firebrands. And when you read the history of the Civil Rights Movement, Martin Luther King was the old man when Julian Bond and John Lewis came along. And so the point being here is we've always had generational tensions. You represent that vanguard generation of prophets today. Number two, I think it's incredibly important to take up the issue of voter suppression. Incredibly important, because if you don't secure that, you can't secure anything else. Number three, it is important to make the connection between activism and civic engagement. So in other words, if your faith compels you to protest and to be in the streets, it must also compel you to participate in the democratic process. And so in other words, it's not enough to hold a sign or to withstand tear gas or write, you gotta participate in the process. Let me give you a concrete example. In Ferguson, Missouri, lots of demonstrations, lots of protests, but only one point of accountability after Michael Brown died. The pattern and practice investigation by the Department of Justice, the settlement. Now ask yourself this question, how did that happen? The Justice Department was able to hold the Ferguson Police Department accountable because of evidence derived from statistics mandated by law the NAACP wrote with young people. Our youth and college division, when we go to a state legislature, we ask young people to testify. We ask young people to write letters. We ask young people to call upon their congressional representatives. The point being here is protest and policy and prophetic religion are connected. It's not enough for us to sit within our houses of worship. We got to be in the streets. Not enough for us to be in the streets, we got to be at the polls. So we got to have a policy, and we have to have a plan, and lastly, we got to be together. We can't tweet by ourselves. You know, I tweet at all times of day and night, not to the extent of other presidential candidates. No policy commentary there. But tweeting alone, necessary but not sufficient. We need to have community when it comes to advocacy and when it comes to social justice. And that means community in, I believe, a multi-generational way. And we've got segmented media. Right, so you know, the reason Facebook is less popular among perhaps people your age is because parents are on Facebook, right? But sometimes, not every day, but sometimes it's good to connect with the parents and grandparents when it comes to making your prophetic religion real. And so that means we need a movement for social justice that has everybody in it, because too often, what I hear is young people want this. As though justice were generationally capsuled. What you want, we want. And we need to want it together, advocate together, connect prophetic religion, policy, the polls, protest together.
Thank you for that question. One more question. I just want to give you coming attractions. As I said, the best story, this is the day that never ends. It's our day of atonement. I see Rabbi Fidel Strauss in the back, Dr. Joe Levy, Leo Bierman, 1:30. Will Graves and Soul Bishop Graves' son, the best, in my opinion, gospel singer who feels at home. We sing with him all the time, our group. He's coming here at 1:30, God willing, from Lane, where he teaches. We'll be doing Ruach in the Sanctuary, honoring Emma's grave and all the seniors. That'll go to 3 o'clock. And then, to follow up on Rabbi Bowman and President Brooks's talk, Daniel Keel's panel, 3 o'clock, 2, to Yisker, to the grand finale, heading to 6:30. He came in at midnight last night. He's got to fly out right after this talk. I'll let you thank him after one more final question from anyone here. Please, Mike.
I'm sorry. Is there, and if so, can you discuss a little bit, a relationship between the NAACP and the American Civil Liberties Union?
Yes, Very much so. So when you look at the voting rights litigation around the country, the criminal justice litigation, the protest demonstration on the ground, around the country, we had the NAACP and the ACLU working together. Concrete example. In New York City, the stop and frisk policy, millions of people affected. 90% of whom were innocent. People stopped, frisked, having police officers without probable cause place their hands all over their bodies, and in so doing, demeaning their dignity and their humanity. That policy was brought to an end as a consequence of the ACLU and the New York State Conference of the NAACP working together, both in the courts and in the community. So when we talk about coalitions, here's what I want you to know. The best coalitions don't often make the New York Times. The biggest demonstrations with young people in Ferguson, we had 1,000 young people with police officers, never made the New York Times. Now, if a kid throws a brick through a window, that's the front page. That ACLU, NAACP connection in the New York State Conference, in California, in Missouri, and we work with ACLU all across the country at a grassroots level, very, very closely.
This is your spiritual home. Stay all day, but President Brooks will stay afterwards for as long as he can, and you can come up and give him a hug. Let's hear it for President Brooks.